Today I'm going to be talking about a pretty tough subject, and one that I believe that is not talked about enough in the adoption community. And I'm only speaking on it because of my research, and because personally I have dealt with this issue my entire life, and it's something that I wish on nobody. But I wouldn't want to have talked to anybody about it other than somebody that has gone through the same thing, that has experience with it. So if you have never experienced this and you don't think this is a helpful video, or that you don't think this is a real thing, I will post the statistics for suicide among adoptees. Last thing I read about it was we're 4 times more likely to take our own lives or attempt to take our own lives than biological children. And it's not that I'm trying to be negative on this channel, it's just that everybody knows already the good side of adoption. The families that are happy with adoptees, they don't really need help. They don't need to be going anywhere for help. I mean, the issues that I grew up with and other adoptees that I hear grow up with are very, very serious issues that usually go denied, dismissed, and unacknowledged. And just because that they're not talked about does not mean that they're not happening. So I am very nervous in talking about these things, but I believe that they must be talked about because I experienced them. What I'm reading about in these books, multiple books or research I've been doing has been speaking on it. So I'm just going to go ahead and read this. It's on the topic of suicide, and I believe it has to be talked about. And again, this is not for me. This is for anybody out there struggling, any adopted parents that may be dealing with a suicidal person, and not understanding what they're feeling or going through or how to be there for them. And I wish that I had somebody to understand what I was going through when I was going through it, and I attempted to do that, and how they responded to me was very unhelpful and sort of shaming. So I'm just going to get into it. This is on page 98 of Betty Jean Lifton's Journey for Adopted Self. It's just going to be a story of Andrew. And this is a group that did research that had a large federal grant to study the mental health of adopted teenagers. So this is a story of 18-year-old college student named Andrew. Man, this is going to be a hard one, dude. I can't promise I'm not going to tear up, but Andrew was a fun-loving teenager, or tender child, who was always for the underdog. His adoptive mother told me, as the youngest of 3 adopted children, he would tag along after his sister, Mary, who was 6 years old when he arrived as a nine-day-old infant. When she talked of finding her other mother, he talked of finding his. The middle child, who was 4 years older than Andrew, would walk out of the room when these discussions came up. Ironically, he would be the one to search first. After the name of his birth mother was inadvertently given to him by the adoption agency, when he was seeking information for a passport application, he looked in the phone book and found it. His birth mother welcomed him, and he became especially close to his grandparents, who lived only 7 miles away. Mary was not to have the same luck. When, after graduating from college, she asked the adoption agency to act as an intermediary, she was told that her mother refused to have contact. Mary's life went into a tailspin. It took several years for her to recover from the negative impact of drugs and abusive relationships. Andrew seemed to change after that too. He felt as if he had lost his sister. He began to write poetry about death, and to do so badly in high school that he almost didn't graduate. In quotes, "I feel sometimes I don't belong in this world," end quote, he'd say, and brood over not knowing anyone he resembled physically. He did not speak anymore of finding his mother. When his adopted father asked him the summer before his death whether he might search for her, he exploded with anger, saying, "She's probably a whore," in quotes. That same summer, in the depth of depression, he told a friend that he needed to know his birth mother, but had decided not to look for her because he was afraid of what he might find. Quotes, "I've closed that door," end quote, he said. There were, of course, other problems in Andrew's life. He had never been able to hold a job, to finish things, or to control his explosive temper. His mother remembers that once during a minor argument with his parents, Andrew picked up a kitchen chair in a blinding rage. She was afraid, for in that moment he was not the Andrew she knew. Later, during a discussion about his anger in family counseling, he said, "I don't remember what happens when I get angry. I black out." In that final summer, while his parents were on vacation, Andrew showed further signs of instability. He lost his driver's license, was fired from the job his father's had arranged, and changed his mind at the last minute of going into the Marines. In the fall, Andrew went to a college in the same state. He made friends quickly in the first 5 weeks, even found a girlfriend, but had trouble with one course. Nico. Sorry, my son's in all these videos. He's two. He is always needing attention. If you have kids, you probably know that. He lost his driver's license. Yeah, okay. In early November, the day before his suicide, he phoned his mother and said he wanted to come home for the weekend. He mentioned a fight with his girlfriend, but gave no hint of his plan, nor did he tell his mother that he had just received his midterm report card with an F in the course that had bothered him. His mother noticed he seemed disorganized when he arrived. He gave a number of reasons for not bringing his dirty clothes home to be washed. No time to collect them, no room in the car. Later, she would understand that he was never going to need those clothes. On the last day of his life, Andrew made a point of having a long talk with his mother. He asked about her studies and encouraged her to pursue her vocational goals no matter what obstacles she might encounter. It was his way of saying goodbye. When his father called from the office to say he would be late coming home for dinner, Andrew said, "Goodbye, Dad," in a choked voice that left his father uneasy. Andrew went out with his friends to eat, have a few beers, go bowling. His parents were in bed when he returned about 1 a.m. A friend he called said that Andrew sounded depressed and had trouble hanging up. Andrew tried to phone his girlfriend, but her mother said it was too late and told him to call back in the morning. According to the coroner, it must have been around 3 a.m. when he shot himself in the basement family room with a gun he used for hunting. He left a sprawling poem, one line of which was, "So much to lose." The suicidologist Edwin Schneidman points out that there is rage, guilt, anxiety, and dependency in the psychodynamics of suicide. The predisposing conditions are feelings of abandonment, helplessness, hopelessness. Quotes, "Every suicide comes from unfulfilled needs," end quote. He writes, quote, "It is an attempt to stop the unbearable anguish or intolerable emotion," end quote. As we have seen, adoptees often feel of abandonment, helplessness, and hopelessness. Andrew seems to have identified with his sister when her mother refused to see her. He must have sensed that he too would be rejected, that he did not have the psychic strength for it. Everything he did after that seemed to send him on a downward spiral. He often apologized to his adopted parents for failing them. Quotes, "I am going to the ancestors of the other worlds," end quote, he wrote in a poem shortly before his death. Perhaps he felt it took less courage to find his birth family in the next world than risk finding them in this one. Parents of children who commit suicide always feel guilty and sense that the community somehow blames them for the death. Andrew's mother remembers pounding the kitchen table in anger that morning when she said, when she and her husband discovered their son's body. Quotes, "Adoption. These kids never feel like that they really belong in this world. Who will understand?" I know this is a long story, so I'm just gonna try to hurry it up. Basically, Andrew was angry at adoption. She would write 8 years later on a book on grief. Even though he was close to us, who were of his adoptive family, he needed to know and claim his birth family. When I imagine the pain he felt, I feel ill. Sorry, I can't speak today. The child I cradled and fed, the scratched knees, the fevers, the bruises we mended, and the pain this deep, I still want to fix it. I am so helpless, forever helpless. Yeah. This is a pretty dark story, but it's honestly my truth, and I saw a lot of myself in that. It's extremely hard to talk about, but it's something that needs to be brought to attention. It's not to be negative or to focus on the negative. It's to help. If somebody is out there struggling with a child of suicide or suicidal tenderness, like, they personally need reunion. If they talk about finding their birth family, if they talk about issues with adoption, the solutions are they need to talk to somebody that can identify them with them. They need to have their needs met. They have extra needs of having two sets of parents. Their biological family, there needs to be a grieving process of that biological family. All the anger, all the resentment for relinquishment. They need to talk to somebody, and they need somebody that truly understands, most likely another adoptee. I know that I never had that growing up. That's why I made this channel. And it is just the feelings of abandonment that never get dealt with. Either trauma can be prolonged if it is ignored, you don't know it's there, or you just basically dismiss it and you say it's in the past, get over it. Or there can be healing and say, hey, you know, these problems probably could be stemming from your adoption and relinquishment. Read The Primal Wound, read you know, The Hurt Child, if you adopted a child from foster care or trafficking. Because it's not like we're just a blank slate that's grateful to be adopted. I mean, we are grateful, yes, but it doesn't mean that we don't have a past and the trauma's still not there. We can be grateful and grieving a loss. So I really hope this helps. I'm not trying to be negative. I genuinely am trying to help, being somebody to identify with of these horrible things that we can go through alone. I personally had to go through this alone. I never had any therapist identify with me or anything like that. And it's just a very extremely dark and lonely road. And I wish I had somebody to talk to about it and be there for me and not shame me for feeling abandoned. And I hope this helps. I genuinely do.